So students, by now we have covered one chapter from Indian economic development. In that we have discussed in the different spheres how did the British spoil the economy of India, okay, and how did the infrastructure developed by the British helped to grow Indian economy, though it did not support in the growth of the Indian economy, but still it could work out to some extent. But moreover Indian economy was spoiled by the British, either the agriculture or industries, foreign trade, each and everything we have discussed in detail in chapter 1. Now we come on the chapter 2. In chapter 2 we were talking about the Indian economy from 1950 to 1990. We had gone through the different economic systems. We had gone through the central problems of an economy, because every country opts the kind of economic system how to solve these central problems of an economy. On the basis of that, every country goes for the kind of economic system. So mainly we have the three kinds of economic systems. These are capitalist, socialist, and the mixed economy. India has gone with that of the mixed economy also. Only reason India could not go with that of the capitalist, because we were not quite rich. And India could not go with that of the socialist concept only, because India did not have these much resources to bear the burden of the economy, to bear the burden of the whole population. So India adopted the passage of the mixed economy. Okay, in the mixed economy, we had already discussed that this is the coexistence of the private and public sectors together. Getting it? So after that, we had gone through the economic planning. After adopting the mixed economic system, India worked on the economic planning. For the purpose, they established the Planning Commission of India. And now it is known as the Niti Aayog from 2015 onwards. Approaches in Niti Aayog has been quite different. In the Planning Commission, we could see the approaches from top to bottom. Whatsoever had been decided by the authorities, by the ministers, all those were supposed to be followed by the rest of the members of the Planning Commission. But now at present, under in Niti Aayog, the approach is from bottom to top. Whatsoever the problems are being faced by the people at the bottom level, okay, they reach their problems through the debate, through the discussions, to the topmost authorities, and the decisions are taken out on the basis of mutual considerations only. Now we come on the goals of the Planning Commission. First of all, question arises, why do we need the goals? As all of us know that if we don't have any goal, okay, so goal is an end towards which efforts are directed. When we decide a goal, then the sphere of our efforts, then the ambit of our efforts are directed, is decided in which direction we have to make the efforts. Okay, and if we don't have any goal, we cannot reach on any destination. Getting it? So reach on any destination, we always need the goals. Now we will see what are the goals of the Planning Commission, or what are the goals of the Niti Aayog. First of all, what is a plan? What do we mean by the plan? A plan tells us how the resources of a nation can be utilized. It can have some general goals as well as some specific goals, which are supposed to be achieved over a period of time. So planning in India mainly focus on these four goals, on these four objectives. Number one, growth. Number two, equitable distribution of distribution or equity, modernization and self-sufficiency. Now we'll discuss all these one by one. First of all, we speak of the growth. If we are talking in terms of growth means, growth refers to an increase. Growth refers to an increase in GDP. What is GDP? I hope this term is not new to you all. What is GDP? Gross domestic product. What do we mean by gross domestic product? Gross domestic product is the market value of all the final goods and services produced in the country during a period of 1 year. We have discussed all these in national income. We have already studied in national income. So we have discussed GDP over there. And we have learned how to calculate GDP even. We can calculate GDP by the different three methods. Or we can calculate national income by the different three methods. We have learned all these things. So basically, in reference of any country, if we are speaking of growth, so growth means growth refers to an increase in GDP, increase in the gross domestic product. As we have taken the example of here, suppose you can consider GDP as a cake. Okay. And growth is increase in the size of the cake. As the size of cake will increase, like this, if the GDP of the country is increasing, it means country is growing. Now question arises, how is the GDP of a country derived? So GDP of any country, this is derived from the different sectors of the economy. All of us know economy has been divided into the different three sectors. Number one, primary sector, secondary sector, and the tertiary sector. The main activity of primary sector is agriculture. The main activity of the secondary sector, manufacturing. And the main activity of the tertiary sector is services, banking, insurance, all these. Okay. So the GDP of a country is derived from the different sectors of the economy, be it agricultural sector, or we could say primary sector, industrial sector, or we could say secondary sector, and the service sector, which can be called the tertiary sector also. The contribution made by each of these sectors makes up the structural composition of the economy. What do we mean by structural composition? Structural composition means the number of people engaged in the different sectors of the economy. This is called the structural composition, or we can say this is known as the occupational structure of the economy. Structural composition means the number of people engaged in the different sectors of the economy. This is known as structural composition. Besides this, when the increase in the flow of goods and services is consistent over a period of time, then we call this the economic growth. Suppose in GDP, we could see some growth. So momentary, on the basis of movements only, if any momentary change has been there in GDP, increase or decrease, that cannot be considered the growth. What would be the growth? When the increase in the flow of goods and services would be consistent over a longer period of time. We could say it may be 5 years, it may be 10 years. Okay. Then we can say that GDP growth leads to the economic growth of the economy. Then it would be called the economic growth. Very minute, very few fluctuations, ups and downs in the increase or decrease of the GDP cannot be called the economic growth. Next comes, now what are the factors on which the increase in GDP depends? Of any country's increase in GDP depends on the two factors. What are these factors? Number one, if the resources of the country are increasing. Okay, if the resources of any country are increasing, then we can say that the GDP will also increase. Because reason, resources are increasing. If the resources are increased, it means employment would be generated into the economy. And if the employment would be generated, then what would happen? Purchasing power, purchasing capacity of the people will be increased. Purchasing power of the country will also increase. Investment will increase. So when the resources are increased, so we can say that the GDP will also increase. Second reason is increase in the productivity. What do we mean by increase in the productivity? Productivity is called output per unit of input. Output per unit of input. This is known as the productivity. Please keep remember, all these are yours one marker. Again and again, we tell you all these are yours one markers. Please listen the videos also attentively and attend the live classes attentively. Okay. Have you get the points? What are the two factors on which the increase in GDP depends? Number one, increase in the resources of the country. And secondly, increase in the productivity. Productivity means output per unit of input. Whatsoever the inputs have been invested into the economy, by the investment of that input, how much output is being generated? This is known as the productivity. And productivity can be increased by using the innovative technology. If the innovative technologies are used, then we can increase the productivity. Now, planning in India ensures that natural resources are fully explored and production technology is continuously improved. This is the result of the planning. By planning, if India has adopted the planning, so planning has been done through the 5 years plan, all of you know. And under these 5 year plans, as if we speak of the first 5 year plan, so in the first 5 year plans, India focused on the improvement of the agriculture only. In the second 5 year plans, India focused on the development of industries only. Getting it? So by planning, what happens? India ensures that natural resources for the particular objective, for the specific outcome, are fully explored and production technology is continuously improved so that GDP growth achieves a momentum. So this is the result of the planning in India. I hope that things are clear. Should we go ahead? Yes, please say something, students. May we go ahead now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, beta. Next, we come on the equitable distribution or equity. Understand this? Okay. Reason, any one marker is always asked out of this equal distribution and equitable distribution. Or sometimes three or four markers are also being given. First of all, what do we mean by equal distribution? See, equal distribution means every individual in the society gets the same share in country's national income. No society would ever seek a situation like this. Get this? What happens? In a society under the equal, if we are speaking of equal distribution, either a doctor, either a person who's working on a on the basis of daily wages, okay, the casual workers, all these are under this concept, equal distribution. All of them are supposed to receive, to avail the same share in the country's national income. Either they are educated enough or not, either they are literate or illiterate, either the doctor or the wages or the casual workers or the rickshaw pullers, everyone will get the same amount, everyone will get the same income if we go with that of the equal distribution. So sometimes this is not known as the negative concept. This is not good for the economy. Now we speak of the equitable distribution. Equitable distribution is known as the positive concept in the economy. Reason is this: it refers to a situation when differences in income are allowed, but only within the certain limits. Here we have some certain limits. Like if the doctor has been there, obviously the income of a doctor, of an engineer, of the officers, it can be at the higher slabs. They can enjoy the higher slabs of the income. But on the other hand, if we could see the casual workers, wages, the uneducated people, they may be the skilled one. Equitable distribution means the people who are the skilled ones, who have the variety of skills, who enjoy some specific skills, okay, they can enjoy the higher slabs of the income, and it will not be considered the negative discrimination. It will not be considered the negative concept because they are earning the higher amount on the basis of their skills. Now here, what would be the role of the government? Government will have to come with that of some positive considerations, with that some of the positive arrangements. Now, how can the government make some positive arrangements for this? In this, government will have to work out to lessen the gap between the rich and the poor. Government can impose the higher tax slabs, higher taxes from the rich people, and it can be spent for the welfare of the people. So like this, the government can create a balance into the economy. So it will be considered as the positive outcomes or the positive discrimination if the government has been working like this. So this is known as the equitable distribution or equity. I hope that this is clear to you all, because sometimes one marker is also put up out of this, and sometimes three or four marker is given essentially. It may be application based question also. They can give you some case study and they can ask from you, how can you justify this? Okay, so you will have to explain this concept over there. So next we come again. Equitable distribution or equity. Economic growth, as we have discussed right now, it would become meaningless exercise if the benefits of growth accrue to only a handful of people in the society. Getting it? The same question has been arising, as we have discussed right now, that the role of the government is very important in the equitable distribution. How can the government play a role? Government can make the arrangements to lessen the gap between the rich and the poor. Government can charge the more taxes, that can impose the more taxes from the rich people. It can charge the more fees from a specific category of the people. Okay, so like this, and these amount can be spent for the welfare of the poor people. So it won't be called as a favoritism of the government, or it won't be called the negative discrimination by the government. It would be considered as the positive discrimination, and it will always work for the equitable distribution in the society. Reason: economic growth will not take place if only the handful people are growing in the society. Under the name of the growth of the handful people, we cannot call it the economic growth. Economic growth will take place when the equitable distribution will take place in the society or in the economy. So what can we observe? Growth serves virtually no purpose in a society where rich tend to become richer and the poor continue to struggle even for the essentials of life. So this is not the economic growth. We have discussed this right now. If the rich are going to be richer, more richer and richer and richer, so this is not the growth if the handful people are enjoying all these things. And on the other hand, few people had been there who are worried, who are scared even how to fulfill the essentials of life, even getting it. So it cannot be called the growth. Benefits of growth must spread across all sections of the society so that the distribution of incomes becomes equitable. We discussed it. Equitable of distribution of income implies social equality also, and this is one of the principal objectives of goals of planning in India, as we discussed it right now. I hope that things are clear. All of you can write down the points for the equitable distribution. Yes, all of you can write down all the points. Okay, beta. So we should move ahead. Now we are going to the second objective, modernization. What do we mean by modernization? See, modernization. In the modernization, we could see the two things mainly. Number one, adoption of the new technology. In a very simple language, we could say modernization is taking place if the new technology is taking place or we are adopting the new technology. Okay, so we can take the example, suppose any farmer has been there. Any farmer can increase the agricultural production by using the modern technology in the agricultural field, harvesters, threshers. Okay, so any farmer can increase the productivity, the output per unit of input. Okay, so it would be called the one aspect of modernization. What is this? Adoption of the new technology or the modern technology. Okay, secondly, change in the social outlook. Second factor which plays an important role to achieve the objective of modernization, these are two. Number one, adoption of the new technology which aims to increase the production of goods and services through the use of new technologies. You can give any example in this. We have given you the example of a farmer. You can give the example of any factory, any firm. It's up to you. You can give any example. This is one of the aspects of modernization. If we are going to be comfortable with that of the use of the new technology, if we are educating people about the use of the new technologies, this is the part of modernization, no doubt. Second is, Change in the social outlook means it requires the change in the social outlook, just like gender empowerment or providing equal rights to women also. Okay, no, there should be no gender inequality. So a society will be more civilized and prosperous if it makes use of the talents of women in the workplace. Because they also have the brain, they also have the talent, they can contribute. Okay. So modernization connects a variety of structural and institutional changes in the framework of economic activity. Getting it? So this is known as the modernization. I hope all of you have gone through this. Modernization refers to the updation, adoption of modern technology in the process of growth. As noted earlier, output can be increased either by increasing the pool of resources or by using innovative technology. Modern age is the age of science and innovation. Science has offered us new ways of doing things, so we can increase the productivity either in farms and factories. We discussed this. Science has offered us new ways of doing things such that productivity in farms and factories has shown an exponential rise over time. Okay, in the social angle, we have already discussed goals of plans in India has a social angle as well. Here it refers to modernization of social outlook. Conventional wisdom wisdom without a valid reason must give way to modern outlook. It includes issues like empowerment of women so that they can also participate in the process of production and contribute to the process of economic and social prosperity. Nowadays, women excel a lot in all the fields. Yes, all of you agree? All the girls agree? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Could you hear me? So long you took in responding, all of you. Okay. So now we come on the next objective. Self-sufficiency. What do we mean by self-sufficiency? We can call this self-reliance also. Okay. Self-sufficiency means overcoming the need of external assistance. It means to have the development through the domestic resources. Means we must be self-dependent. We must not be dependent on the others. We should not be dependent on other countries. We must be self-dependent. Means we must use the domestic resources much more and more and more. Getting it? If we need even a needle, if we need even a all pin, so we must use the domestic resources only. We must not demand from the neighbors, yes, we need the all pin or we need the pins and you just give it to us, please. We would like to purchase it from you. It should not be like that, okay? If we need anything, it must be, so we must be self-dependent. Means we must use the domestic resources. The manufacturing must take place in our country only, and people should get employment in our country only, so that we could become the self-sufficient. We must import to the lesser side. We must import less to less. We must make the efforts to export more, so that the economy can grow. We must make the efforts that we could sell more rather than purchasing, so that we could earn the income, so that we could become self-sufficient. Okay? So self-sufficiency means dependence on domestically produced goods, particularly food grains. This goal was accorded a high priority during the first 7 plans. The basic idea was not to expose Indian economy to political pressure from rest of the world. Simply, we are dependent upon them for the supply of essential goods. India wanted to be self-sufficient in food grain production to avoid the uncertainties of supplies from the rest of the world. The policy of self-reliance was considered a necessity because, number one, to reduce the foreign dependence. Number one, to reduce the foreign dependence. And secondly, to avoid the foreign interference also. Did you get the point? Number one, we needed the self-sufficiency because, number one, to reduce the foreign dependence. And secondly, to avoid the foreign interference. So these were the main reasons that we must be the self-sufficient. Now we come full employment. What is the full employment? It refers to a situation when all the people are able to work and willing to work at the market wage rate are getting work. In other words, those who are able to work and willing to work must get work. This is the social objectives of planning. One marker is sometimes this is asked, what's the social objective of planning? And you are given the options, growth, modernization, full employment. Okay, so all of you tick growth. Okay, if specifically it includes the option of full employment for the social objective, so please tick on the social objective only. Then tick on this only. Okay, so that's why we have mentioned in the PDF mein specially isko mention kiya gaya hai. This is the social objective of planning. So those who are able to work and willing to work must get work. This is known as the full employment. Okay. What is the objective of the full employment? Number one, more and more people should participate in the process of growth. Second, benefits of growth must be shared across wider sections of the society, as we discussed about the equitable distribution. Okay, so these the benefits must be shared across the wider sections of the society. So it refers to achieve the growth with social justice. Setting a goal is not the main thing. It is deciding how you will go about achieving it and staying with that plan. I hope that things are clear. Yes, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Everything is clear. Okay, so submit the work on time. Now, we'll start the next topic. Part 3. That would be the part 3 of the IED. Today, I'll upload the video. Okay, thank you, beta. God bless you.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, welcome, beta. God.